Penguin Random House Canada presents How to Be a Climate Optimist, Blueprints for a Better World by Chris Turner. Read for you by the author. For Sloan, who teaches me every day how to get better at building a better world. And for Alexander, who reminds me every day why that better world is so urgently needed. We inhabit, in ordinary daylight, a future that was unimaginably dark a few decades ago, when people found the end of the world easier to envision than the impending changes in everyday roles, thoughts, practices that not even the wildest science fiction anticipated. Perhaps we should not have adjusted to it so easily. It would be better if we were astonished every day. Rebecca Solnit, Hope in the Dark. 1.0. How to be a climate optimist. 1.1. A better world waits. I'm a climate optimist. There's nothing starry-eyed or Pollyanna-like about it. It's not a slogan or a marketing pitch. It's something I earned. By accident, in a sense. By the time these lines meet a reader's eyes, my oldest child will be 17 years old. I first became obsessed with the scale of the mounting climate catastrophe in the year before we started our family, horrified by the coming devastation. This was not a common sentiment in those days. From the point of view of someone worrying over the real issues of the day, war, terrorism, corporate malfeasance, the economy, climate fears were fringe concerns to be found over a horizon too distant to even see. But I'd talked to a few climate scientists and read some reports in the obscure technical science news, and I was convinced to my core that there would be no public issue in my lifetime as consequential as our collective response to climate change. And I wondered how to tell this horror story with enough shock and awe to make it as urgent as a dispatch from the front lines in a war zone. I outlined a series of magazine features, a sort of world tour of the world's climate hotspots. Disappearing Pacific islands, melting glaciers, receding coastlines, dried up farmlands. A map of catastrophe. I had an interested editor ready to write a check to cover the round-the-world ticket I would need to write those stories. And then the magazine he edited went bankrupt, and the climate horror stories shifted to my mental back burner as I started a family. With my wife pregnant with our first child and the horizon of my responsibility stretching beyond my own lifetime, I reacquainted myself with my shelved climate hotspots idea. But then I imagined my kids' earliest memories perhaps being colored by trips to islands that would become uninhabitable and glaciers soon to vanish forever. What a grotesque gift that would be. And so I stood the idea on its head. What would a world tour of places that were beating climate change look like? I'd never given focused thought to what sustainability or resilience means, to how energy is made at national or global scales, to what causes a society's or a world's population to choose to burn fossil fuels to meet nearly all its daily needs. But I had a notion that someone already had to be working on solutions, that those solutions might work, that I might be able to stitch them together into a makeshift map of a better world. That became my primary occupation for the next 17 years and counting. I measured the depth of my experience on the beat by the birthdays and milestones of my kids. I watched the oldest one march off to a student climate strike not too long ago, feeling not guilt at what the world had become, or terror at what the future might bring, but instead confidence in the certainty, cautious and qualified, but a certainty nonetheless, that the tools to build that better world were waiting for those kids. This is what I mean when I say I've earned my optimism. If I had little to offer my children after 17 years of searching, I wouldn't be able to make any reasonable claim to optimism. If I'd scoured the world and interviewed the experts and attended all the wonky conferences and trade shows and come away with nothing to show for it but best intentions and wishful thinking, I'd be delusional, if not downright fraudulent, in my optimism. Thankfully, my naive hunt has returned in abundance. I've seen the solutions, tracked their development and growth, watched them spread from the freak fringe of garage tinkerers and hardcore green survivalists and, okay, yes, Scandinavians, to the front page news of big business, global politics, mainstream industry, and everyday life. I've been to the better world. I've talked to its architects and toured its facilities. I've seen the tools that work and the ones that don't. When I say I'm a climate optimist, I mean that, in the face of the existential challenge of climate change, I believe the world will develop and implement better systems and technologies to meet our daily needs and reduce our global greenhouse gas emissions to somewhere very near zero in this century. It likely won't happen in time to halt the permanent alteration of many of the planet's ecosystems and prevent significant dislocation and suffering for millions of people. But it will occur with enough speed and thoroughness to leave a foundation for civilization durable enough for future generations to build their dreams on. And that's about the same as any generation's ever done for the ones to come. I'd like to show you how I became a climate optimist. Set aside your anxiety and dread and skepticism for a little while. They'll still be there when I'm done. Let's see where a little hope and ingenuity and even some exuberance and delight can take us. 1.2. Doom's limits. Doom is easy now. Maybe doom has always been low effort, but it's straight up effortless now. Catastrophe, Armageddon, nuclear winter, or zombie apocalypse. These scenes are everywhere, because they're not that hard to dream up. No need even to invest your imagination in the work of inventing nightmare images and fantastical tales of roaring hellfire, or wrath of God hurricanes, or swelling pestilence. They are recurring features in the nightly news, and the stuff of memes up and down every social media feed. The sky is on fire, the oceans in tumult, the glaciers vanishing, the fish stocks collapsing, the coral reefs bleached ghostly white. The end is surely nigh, or at least one of the most likely nighs. Doom is easy indeed. We're steeped in doom, awash in devastation, swimming in despair. And our brains are always up for more, riddled with biases and tics that make us hyper-aware of impending threats and prone to assume that one freak misfortune will soon lead to more of the same. That's why everyone still wants a ticket to the disaster movie. Everyone still sings along to the sad songs of collapse. A hard rain's gonna fall. It's the end of the world as we know it. This is it, the apocalypse. BuzzFeed posts a listicle under the title 17 Signs the World is Definitely Over by Next Thursday Latest. Everyone clicks. But then Thursday comes and goes, and there's another day and another after that. That's when you need something more than impending doom to keep you going. So let's set doom aside. Not because the end is any less nigh, necessarily, not because the catastrophe is averted by denying its existence, but because we have to keep going in the face of it. Let's focus instead on the bed we have to lie down in regardless, the home it's in, the way the lights stay on and the place is kept warm or cool, how we get from there to work and school and back again. Let's focus on living. Living better. 1.3. Embrace dark euphoria. Bruce Sterling is a science fiction author and thinker who has spent his career examining the ways rapidly advancing technology is reshaping human existence. He is perhaps best known as one of the progenitors of the sci-fi genre known as cyberpunk, which emerged in the early 1980s and anticipated the staggering wave of innovations and transformations in digital technology that are now ubiquitous. Sterling is interested not so much in what technology can do as in how it shapes the culture, how it makes people feel and act, how it defines their sense of what is possible and desirable, and what is horrifying. Back in 2009, at a progressive tech conference called Reboot 11 in Copenhagen, he delivered a closing keynote address on the subject of grand future narratives. "What is the cultural temperament of this era?" Sterling asked the small knot of hackers and coders in the room. "Well, I think it's got a good two-word summary, dark euphoria." Dark euphoria is what the 20-teens feel like. Things are just falling apart. You can't believe the possibilities. It's like anything is possible, but you never realize you're going to have to dread it so much. It's like a leap into the unknown. Sterling's dark euphoria meme never really caught on. Not like the roaring 20s, the last generation, turn on, tune in, drop out, the me decade, the slacker generation. Maybe it's one of those coinages that looks most prophetic in retrospect. Or perhaps it'll simply flow away forever down the noisy currents of the internet. Which would be unfortunate, because it so succinctly captures the general mood of these first decades of the 21st century. The darkness arises from a mounting sense that the concept of human progress that has driven idealists and inspired huddled masses for centuries has stalled out. That promise of progress, in Sterling's summary, was this. You get more scientific knowledge, you create more tools, make more jobs, you master nature, you get more power, cheaper power, you struggle for a better life for your children, you're looking for health, prosperity, material security, shelter. Bigger, faster, stronger, knowing more. Everybody knows that's progress. A brighter future, basically, or at least one with more opportunity and wonder in it than this one. And that vision of progress appears to have vanished. The actual objective situation looks more like this. No money, scarcity, financial collapse, collapsed states, general precarity, an energy crisis, low-intensity global warfare, and a rapidly advancing climate crisis. On the climate front, Sterling rails against what he calls hair-shirt green environmentalism. For many of us, this is what we think of as environmental activism's, and thus climate activism's, default mode. Do less, consume less, live in smaller apartments, drive smaller vehicles, take shorter trips and fewer flights. Switch to reusable shopping bags, outlaw plastic straws, maybe put off having a family, a child, opt out of the joy of creation. To which Sterling responds, stop acting dead. Hair shirt green, he says, is simply a reversal of polarity on the existing system. an inversion, a series of rejections. It's not creative or inventive, let alone exciting or inspiring. It's an itchy shirt, there to remind you constantly that you use too much fabric. I didn't discover Sterling's dark euphoria talk until 10 years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.